That's no moon. It's a space station.
Star Wars was the ultimate celluloid gamble.
I remember thinking it's really hard to keep a straight face doing this stuff.
I mean, there's this giant guy in a dog suit walking around. It was ridiculous.
We had no money to stay anywhere, and we got paid nothing.
That became an unstoppable force.
There were lines around the block.
No one thought it would do what it did, but what happened changed everything.
From the opening scroll...
And suddenly the film starts, and every kid in the audience started screaming.
I had never seen anything in a movie, anything like that.
To the story behind the smoothest line in the galaxy.
I love you.
I love you too. That was the line that was written.
So I suggested that we change the line.
I know.
And like a pimp, he just says, I know.
Star Wars transformed a generation.
My whole career may be built on, you know, talking about the Death Star.
I was going to marry Luke Skywalker. He was truly the love of my life.
And lives on today.
I'm real excited about getting it on DVD. And I've always was wondering, what took so long?
These are the stories of Hollywood's greatest space epic, told by the people who lived them.
We were keeping many secrets about the film.
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
Irvin Kershner brought me aside and said, here's what the real story is.
When Star Wars ruled the world.
In a world where only lightsabers sold.
And the dark side was a crime.
Our heroes were taken over and turned into action figures.
And so began a time of pure
Skywalker.
Where only the Force reigned.
And Jedi was the name of the game.
When Star Wars ruled the world.
In the 70s, most films were more realistic, more hard-edged, more a reflection of their times.
People were still reeling from Vietnam and the tension. I don't think there were a lot of movies out that you sat there having a good time at.
Films like Raging Bull and Taxi Driver.
The 70s were kind of era of the independence.
At that time, you had all of these wonderful filmmakers that were emerging.
Coppola, Scorsese, and
Kubrick, of course.
That's when I was first turned on to George Lucas.
George had a pretty good idea of wanting to do something like Flash Gordon was from the 1930s.
He is a brave man and will be royally rewarded.
So we started from scratch on the idea of a science fiction space opera-like story. And that became Star Wars.
No! No!
Well, I knew George Lucas from American Graffiti. I was working part-time as a carpenter at Goldwyn Studio. One morning early, George Lucas walked in with Richard Dreyfuss for the first interview for Star Wars. Several weeks later, I was asked if I would help George and his casting director read other actors who were auditioning for the part.
Anything like it? That's impossible. What's going on?
Empire must have gotten here first.
The planet's been totally blown away. We have to find the rebels. What we're carrying belongs to them.
All right.
You got a ship. But where do we go from here?
It was clear that he was really good for the Han Solo part, so he became the first choice.
I was fortunate enough to get the part.
A friend of mine said, have you gone out for that new George Lucas movie? It's supposed to be like Flash Gordon. I'll never forget reading the screenplay for the first time and thinking, oh my gosh. Because it was called The Adventures of Luke Skywalker is taken from the Journal of the Wills, Saga Number One, The Star Wars. I went in and did a video screen test. George seemed uncomfortable with me peppering him with questions. I certainly didn't have the sense when I left where, well, I really nailed that.
They read anybody that was my age and living that was in California, if not in New York.
When little R2 has been safely delivered to my forces, you'll receive your reward.
So I went in and read.
Carrie Fisher ended up being the ideal one, even though on the surface she wasn't necessarily as classically Hollywood pretty as some of the others.
I got the job of this movie with the caveat that I lose 10 pounds. And I went to a fat farm. It was a nightmare. I was terrified they were going to look at me and say, bring in Jodie Foster and get that fat girl out of here.
She had the right kind of personality. She was feisty and she was witty, and it just worked for the character.
I think what happened was that they picked a trio. They picked a princess, a pirate, and a farm boy.
They weren't similar, but they were similar in strength.
It was 1976. I think that was when we started.
We were gonna go to North Africa and do all the desert scenes.
The first day's filming in the desert in Tunisia was absolutely ingrained on my memory.
We'd come a week after Jesus of Nazareth had filmed, and it just seemed so odd to be in such an antiquated environment doing something that was meant to be futuristic.
In Tunisia, we had high winds and we had sandstorms, but that's pretty normal for the Sahara Desert.
Probably the most scary moment was when I just realized they were talking about the melting point of plastic. As in, how hot can this suit get before it starts to melt?
Kenny Baker played R2-D2 some of the time because he really was a radio-controlled robot.
They'd say, cut, lunch, 1 hour, and they'd all walk away for lunch and leave me in the robot.
My costume would regularly break. In the middle of a scene, they'd suddenly say, his eyes went out, or his leg just dropped off. George would come and frown at somewhere on my body. It wasn't my fault.
I went to England to do costume fittings and meet the crew on the British side of things.
And we had no really any money to stay anywhere. And we got paid nothing. So there was no budget, nothing.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
Very first day on the set, we were running down the Death Star. Very first day of shooting for Carrie. And she disappeared, and she came back about 20 minutes later. She said, ooh. I said, what? They taped me down. She had been running, and she wasn't wearing a bra.
They saw some rushes, and it indicated that maybe a bra was in order. There is no lingerie in space. So they put gaffer tape. And I thought that it would be nice for the crew if they auctioned off who would get to rip the tape off at the end of the day. But they never did that.
There was a general atmosphere on the set that we were making a complete turkey.
Well, it was clear what the English crew were thinking. They would stand around all day long shaking their heads and sighing.
The shooting crew in London was not particularly enamored with the project.
I mean, there's this giant guy in a dog suit walking around. It was ridiculous.
At least my costume was comfortable.
I remember thinking it's really hard to keep a straight face doing this stuff. I mean, Alec Guinness sitting next to a Wookiee. What's wrong with this picture?
On Star Wars, nobody gave a hoot about what we were filming.
There were executives at the studio that felt that it was a folly and that it should never have been done.
The Christmas of 76, 6 months before it opened, I said to Carrie, hey, you know what? They're showing the trailer at the Avco embassy. Let's go stick our heads in.
20th Century Fox and George Lucas bring you an adventure unlike anything on your planet.
And all I know is at the end of the trailer, it says,
a billion years in the making, Star Wars.
And it's coming to your galaxy this summer. And there's a big explosion. And someone, a wise guy in the back goes, yeah, and it's coming to late night TV about 2 months after that.
Coming up, Star Wars opens with a bang.
Suddenly the film starts and every kid in the audience started screaming.
I had never seen anything in a movie, anything like that.
And later, stone cold love.
So I suggested that we change the line.
I love you.
I know.
And like a pimp, he just says, I know.
Next on When Star Wars Ruled the World.
When Star Wars Ruled the World.
The day it was released was a Wednesday, May 25th.
My aunt decided to take a whole bunch of us out to the movies to see this new thing, Star Wars.
I brought my kid, he was about 12 years old, and suddenly the film starts, and every kid in the audience started screaming.
All of a sudden, you just get this explosion of music. And you see the credits crawling up the screen. It was like every Flash Gordon and Buck Rogers episode that I'd ever seen on television, a hundredfold. Luke Skywalker, Han Solo, and Princess Leia trying to wrest the galaxy from the forces of evil.
I remember, you know, sitting in the first scene, and this giant spaceship comes in, flies over the audience. I had never seen anything in a movie, anything like that.
The biggest shock to me was the score.
John Williams' music, it's something that stays with you forever.
I had conversations with George that the music shouldn't be futuristic. The music should be emotional and heroic and even imperial in some cases.
Darth Vader, definitely one of the more menacing, more intimidating movie villains that's ever been created.
The creation of that costume and so on is so unique and so powerful.
You have to credit to the voice of James Earl Jones, who has such a commanding voice.
Where are those transmissions you intercepted? What have you done with those plans?
And you also have to give it up for the breathing, which is impossible to duplicate on the playground. So you couldn't be like, Luke, I'm coming for you.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
Enough of this. Vader, release him.
As you wish.
I was going to marry Luke Skywalker. He was truly the love of my life.
He was a wide-eyed innocent, you know, and here he finds this spiritual mentor in Obi-Wan.
What is it?
Your father's lightsaber. This is the weapon of a Jedi Knight. Not as clumsy or random as a blaster.
The lightsaber was a fantastic invention. Just the idea of, like, turning something on and a sword emerges, and it's a laser sword.
Well, the first time I saw the lightsaber, I was very disappointed because it was a handle with batteries in it, with wires, and they'd come in and put a pole on it. Very unimpressive.
That one.
Remember, a Jedi can feel the Force flowing through him.
Well, the concept of the Force is religion's greatest hits.
I thought the Force was very mysterious. It was a kind of a magical, mystical type of a power that you could summon up and use to control things.
Let me see your identification.
You don't need to see his identification.
We don't need to see his identification.
But yeah, I tried using it on my parents when I wanted some sweets, but it never worked.
The Force can have a strong influence on the weak-minded.
Do you really think we're going to find a pilot here that'll take us to Alderaan?
Han Solo. I'm Captain of the Millennium Falcon.
What a piece of junk!
I kept telling George it would be a real good idea if I could get into the cockpit of the Millennium Falcon before it was finished. And when we finally did, I turned to George and said, okay, now, how do you drive this thing? And it became immediately clear that no one had thought about how you drive it. And George said, well, you just throw switches and stuff like that, you know.
Short for a stormtrooper.
Princess Leia was really a woman ahead of her time. She wasn't afraid, and she was intelligent.
The character was not ever written as a damsel in distress.
I don't know who you are or where you came from. From now on, you do as I tell you, okay?
I don't think anybody can forget Princess Leia's hairdo, the buns.
When they tried that hairstyle on me, George said, well, you like it? And I said, I think it's fantastic. I thought it was terrible.
Mark Hamill's haircut is even worse than Princess Leia's, I think.
There wasn't anything you could have done.
Come on, buddy, we're not out of this yet.
All pilots to your stations.
Luke, the Force will be with you.
The whole final battle with the Death Star knocked us all out, you know, and I thought that was a great scene.
The science of that movie doesn't really hold up to much scrutiny.
A small one-man fighter should be able to penetrate the outer defense.
You know, it's just like you gotta aim for this little shaft they left in the Death Star that apparently could destroy the whole thing. Shoot there. Han gets a medal. And Luke gets a medal. Chewie's just like, they're like, don't give the dog anything. Which is kind of insulting because, you know, he did risk his life as well.
How many dogs can actually drive the family car?
Nobody ever explained to me why I didn't get that medal.
Maybe they thought he'd eat it or something.
But if you notice, he gets the last line in the movie.
And after I came out of that movie theater, it was incredible. I wanted to be Luke Skywalker. I wanted to fly an X-Wing. I wanted to have a lightsaber and battle Darth Vader. I was hooked.
Then I went home that evening and told my mum about the movie. And, you know, it took me sort of 2 hours to tell her the story because there was so much. My head was full of it. And so it had a huge impact on me.
The television news every night was talking about people standing in line to see Star Wars for the 18th time.
I've seen Star Wars about a dozen times.
17 times.
Star Wars, 22 times.
40 times, and it was great each time.
All together, we have seen Star Wars 324 times.
There were lines around the block.
We've been here for 6 days, and it's
residents in LA were angry because people were peeing in their gardens. I mean, plants died to bring you this movie.
They kicked everyone in the ass, and no one thought it would do what it did. But what happened changed everything.
Coming up, Star Wars mania.
Star Wars suddenly seeped into every aspect of our culture. It was everywhere, man. You couldn't escape it.
New C-3PO cereal from Kellogg's.
Dramatic Star Wars drapes.
Look, it's the princess!
There was no way to assimilate it. It made the character Princess Leia famous, and I looked like her.
My anonymity was gone, like that.
And later, bondage and discipline.
We were really shocked to see Carrie's slave outfit.
Because it was really sexy.
Because it was a metal bathing suit, it didn't adhere to the skin when you laid down. So if there was anyone back here, he could see all the way to Florida.
It didn't do a lot for 3PO, but as we know, he's not really into that kind of thing.
Next on When Star Wars Ruled the World.
When Star Wars Ruled the World.
When Star Wars first came out, it made a major impact in America.
Star Wars was the highest grossing film of all time.
Star Wars suddenly seeped into every aspect of our culture. It was everywhere, man. You couldn't escape it.
New C-3PO cereal from Kellogg's.
Dramatic Star Wars drapes.
Look, Skywalker, go along with this or I'll cut you in half. Look, it's the princess.
Hey, it's Luke Skywalker.
And the princess.
Gee.
It's Kenner's new Star Wars action figures, each sold separately.
I got you now, Ben Kenobi.
I had every action figure that was ever made.
Instead of going out and playing football anymore, it was sitting inside playing with the action figures.
Han Solo's figure looked nothing like Han Solo.
I thought it was purposefully done in case they decided to replace me.
Actually, that action figure is in much better shape than I am.
You only knew it was Luke because Leia had a lightsaber that came out of his hand.
My eldest son, Nathan, went over to these other kids that were playing, and he held up a Luke, and he goes, "This is my dad." They all went, "Yeah, right."
There was no way to assimilate it. It made the character Princess Leia famous, and I looked like her, and so it made your life completely different.
My anonymity was gone, like that.
We had never seen a film generate that kind of interest ever, and we knew there'd be a sequel.
There was a certain sigh of relief as Star Wars became popular enough to make Empire Strikes Back, and for us it was, oh boy, it'll be fun to see the gang again.
There was a little bit more pressure.
I was looking forward to it, and I suddenly thought, oh dear, this is going to be Star Wars 2, and it's not going to be as good.
And there was a certain anxiety that, you know, there's no way we're going to be able to do anything but disappoint people. And we all had doubts. You know, how can we top it?
I saw The Empire Strikes Back on opening day.
May 22nd, 1980. I waited in line for that. I wanted to be the first one to see it.
Empire Strikes Back. It was deeper and darker.
It was a good, hard-hitting story. It was very much the second act of a three-act play because everybody had problems. Everybody was in deep trouble.
One of the best sequences in that movie is the first appearance of the AT-ATs, also known as the Snowwalkers. There's that quiet, you know, when suddenly in the distance you see these things that look like elephants, big metal elephants.
I remember shooting footage of an elephant, Margie the elephant, just to get footage to study as how legs moved, a sense of weight. And the walkers and all that was challenging. We did all kinds of tricks. If there's bad animation in the walkers, if a pop happened, we put a laser hitting it instead of reshooting it. It was quite an elaborate setup.
And that was far more impressive than the Death Star.
Do is find this Yoda, if he even exists.
Well, when I read about Yoda in the script, I was wondering how they were going to do it. I mean, he was supposed to be a more awesome Jedi than Obi-Wan.
Yoda was an 800-year-old, brilliant, empowered creature.
We were worried that that a puppet would look like a puppet and not be real enough.
You don't want to see Yoda as a puppet. The character has to transcend what it is.
Frank Oz and the puppeteers really brought that character to life, you know. Hats off to those guys who decided, like, I know, let's just make him talk like an idiot, you know, and give him Frank Oz's voice, but make him the smartest man in the movie.
I asked George if I could push that syntax more, the what people call the backward talk.
I'm looking for someone.
Looking? Found someone you have, I would say. Hmm?
Everybody started talking backwards. Money I owe you? To the commissary you are going?
I don't sense it's backwards, and I don't think Yoda believes it's backwards. It's formal because he's really kind of upholding the past and what Jedis were then.
Through the Force, things you will see, other places, the future, the past, old friends long gone. Han? Leia?
Stop what?
That whole movie, it just builds up to it. And you're just, come on, just kiss her, just kiss her.
And he's looking at her, wondering, Would I like to go to bed with her? Because if he isn't thinking that, he's not Han Solo.
I happen to like nice men.
Nice men.
That was the equivalent of watching porn when I was a child. And then, you know, C-3PO showed up and totally blocked the whole affair, but,
Sir, I've isolated the reverse power flux coupling.
Because if there is one area that 3PO is slightly deficient in, it is in the bedroom.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh, you're perfectly welcome, sir.
Lando system?
Lando's not a system, he's a man.
He's just a guy in space doing his thing.
Hello, what have we here?
I like the fact that he looks at Princess Leia and says, ooh, I think I'd like a little bit of that.
People don't give credit to Lando Calrissian for playing all the angles.
I had no choice. They arrived right before you did. I'm sorry.
Kids would run up to me and say, you betrayed Han Solo. And I'd find myself, you know, trying to explain. And they forget that Lando really was in a dilemma.
What's going on, buddy? You're being put into carbon freeze.
My favorite moment in Empire Strikes Back is when Han Solo is about to be frozen in carbonite, and Princess Leia says, I love you.
And we shot it. I love you. I love you, too.
I thought it was a wasted opportunity for character and for humor.
I love you, too. That's not Han Solo to repeat what his girl would say.
So I suggested to Kirsch that we change the line.
I love you.
I know.
And like a pimp, he just says, I know.
It just kicks you in the gut because we lose. Harrison gets turned into a coffee table. It's so unexpected.
Coming up, who's your daddy?
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
It's like one of the great all-time shockers in movies.
And later, that's a wrap.
It was a major part of my life. I feel very fortunate to have been a part of that.
I began to hear people saying, you know, may the Force be with you.
If you'll pardon my stealing a film line, the Force is with us.
Give me a break.
Next on When Star Wars Ruled the World.
When Star Wars Ruled the World.
With Empire, there was this great challenge.
We were keeping many secrets about the film.
And I thought that if we pull it off, it's going to be even better than the first one.
No escape. Don't make me destroy you.
Irvin Kershner brought me aside and said, look, you're gonna know this, George knows this, and I know this. You can't tell anybody, but here's what the real story is.
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough. He told me you killed him.
No.
It's like one of the great all-time shockers in movies.
Wait, what?
I am your father.
Darth Vader is Luke's father?
That's not true. That's impossible.
It was very sort of Greek.
What a way to send a 9-year-old out into the world.
In 80, when Empire came out, there was a big rush from the press again.
There was now something to keep up, a reputation that you had to outdo.
I thought, how are we going to top Dad Vader?
We had to make a movie that was equally as good, if not better, to continue the story. And when we were doing Return of the Jedi, we already knew how successful the other films had been.
From the very beginning, they had safely guarded the story so that it didn't leak out beforehand.
The fans would show up and start scavenging, looking for anything that might be cool, a ship or a piece of a ship or whatever it would be.
So they began doing Jedi under mock titles.
They came up with the idea of Blue Harvest horror. Beyond imagination.
It was like being in a secret club. Everybody really knew, wink, wink, what it really was.
Return of the Jedi was, I think, the first time I ran into costumed fans.
And I remember all the lines and the craziness around it.
I went to see Return of the Jedi at the Middletown Multiplex. It was packed.
Look, Jabba, I was just on my way to pay you back, and I got a little sidetracked. It's not my fault.
Jabba the Hutt was a powerful sort of like warlord.
First time I saw Jabba in Return of the Jedi, it was very, very cool, and it was just kind of like Yoda taken to the next level, where it's just like instead of a little puppet, here's a massive puppet.
Well, when I first saw Jabba the Hutt, it was just motionless. But then with the remote control of the eyes from someone outside, a couple of people inside doing the tail and all the goo, and he was horrific, and the voice was wonderful.
We have powerful friends. You're going to regret this.
Jabba the Hutt spoke Huttese, which is basically this reworked Indian language that had a very powerful sound to it. And we added a lot of other sounds, like my wife's cheese casserole.
We were really shocked to see Carrie's slave outfit.
Because it was really sexy.
She was hot.
Because it was a metal bathing suit, it didn't adhere to the skin when you laid down. So if there was anyone back here, he could see all the way to Florida.
I would stand behind Jabba for days on end, gazing occasionally down at Carrie. It didn't do a lot for 3PO, but as we know, he's not really into that kind of thing.
When I think back on Star Wars and George Lucas's accomplishments, I think that he's to be lauded and praised for creating a series of characters that are unique and memorable.
Ewoks, you know, they were just a little too cuddly for my taste.
As a kid, I was a huge fan of the movies. So you can imagine at 11 years old, I was very lucky to get this scene with Carrie Fisher. She used to be there with chocolate milk and cookies. She was very, very caring like that, sort of mothered me.
It was so hot. We shot in the summer, and they were fainting.
The Ewoks were always falling over.
And if you fell over, you couldn't get up again because you were like a ball of rubber and fur.
I thought the Ewoks were cute, how these little furry creatures in their primitive ways could topple an empire.
It all comes together in this final battle right here. This crucial lightsaber battle is what everything is all about.
I had a feeling that, you know, Luke Skywalker was going to win out in the end. But I was interested to see if Darth Vader was going to die.
The character had reached almost a mythical proportion of what is underneath there.
This dude who's got this black man's voice and this black man's appearance, you know, is a crusty old white man underneath when they rip off that helmet, and it's just kind of disappointing.
And it didn't, I don't think, had a very successful ending with a teddy bear picnic.
Now I got to hug Harrison Ford's leg. Which makes women jealous.
I think after that, there was nothing more to say.
We
loved the movie. We were totally blown away by it.
And I remember feeling some sort of sense of completion, like, well, I could die now because I've seen all three of these movies. This is the only thing I really needed to do in life.
You know, it's like being a senior in high school, clearing out your locker, because all written all over it was the end.
Coming up, all spaced out.
I was glad that it was wrapping up, because I couldn't devote much more of my masculinity or my dignity to Star Wars and hope to ever get laid.
People say, well, what about fans? Are they? The question's always, are they geeky?
I never anticipated having to remember what model of spacecraft I flew to Dagobah.
There was a person whose legal name was Luke Skywalker. Now, that's worrisome.
Next on When Star Wars Ruled the World.
When Star Wars Ruled the World.
When we finished Return of the Jedi, we knew that this was the last film.
I was very sad to finish filming because it was the end of my adventure at that point.
It's rough emotionally to really bond with these people and then break up and not know when you're going to see them again.
It was a major part of my life. I feel very fortunate to have been a part of that.
I didn't expect any of it to happen, so I think I lived the whole thing like it was going to end.
We thought it would just kind of blow over, but it hasn't.
There were times I wanted to get away from it, and no matter which country I went to, however much I tried to avoid it, there would be an image of 3PO.
I began to hear people saying, you know, may the Force be with you.
If you will pardon my stealing a film line, the Force is with us.
Give me a break.
I was glad that it was wrapping up, because I couldn't devote much more of my masculinity or my dignity to Star Wars and hope to ever get laid.
Star Wars was everywhere. It's become part of our society, our social history.
Star Wars is almost an infinite possible universe to be explored by writers and artists.
The fan films I've seen of Star Wars are incredible.
I'm your father, I'm your father, I'm your father, I'm your father.
I like Spaceballs as kind of a parody of Star Wars.
A power known throughout the universe as the...
The Force?
No, the Schwartz.
The hardest thing about doing Spaceballs was not laughing when they said action.
Will you turn that thing off?
What?
What is it? What did you like better, Jedi or The Empire Strikes Back?
Empire.
Blasphemy.
My whole career may be built on, you know, talking about the Death Star, because we did it in the first movie we did called Clerks.
Excuse me, I don't mean to interrupt, but what are you talking about?
The ending of Return of the Jedi.
My friend here is trying to convince me that any independent contractors who were working on the uncompleted Death Star were innocent victims when it was destroyed by the rebels.
First thing people would talk about after the movie was done was that scene, because A, the scene's funny, and B, it just meant something to people.
People say, well, what about fans? Are they? The question's always, are they geeky?
I never anticipated having to remember what model of spacecraft I flew to Dagobah.
People say to me, with the Blastec 3.335 rifle, did you have that in Return of the Jedi, or did you have it in The Empire Strikes Back? I said, I'm terribly sorry, that's classified information.
And this little boy is about 4 years old. He said to me, are you in Star Wars? And I said, yeah. He says, I'm George, and there's my little brother. He's called Lucas.
There was a person whose legal name was Luke Skywalker. Now, that's worrisome.
Sometimes I just don't understand human behavior.
I did not want to go for the typical goober Star Wars wedding.
Nikki and I were dressed up as Jedis. Our guests were dressed up in assorted Star Wars characters. And Yoda was our ring bearer.
This thing has a power that somehow is beyond what it is.
In this world that we live in, you know, we want to have something else to look to, some sort of hope. And I think Star Wars gives people that.
Star Wars has more than lived through generations, through time.
We went back to the trilogy and remastered the films, and they can be heard better than they were ever played back in their original release.
I'm really excited about getting it on DVD just because of the quality of it.
Also, I look forward to the day when we can have the whole story available as one chronicle and another set of DVDs.
The films that follow the original three films are very different.
Phantom Menace, The Attack of the Clones.
I will be completing now in just a few months the sixth episode. As far as I know, that will be the end of the series, but I wouldn't bet on it.
Star Wars ruled the world for a while, and it really ruled it.
It still rules the world.
Part of it never will die.
It was a phenomenon.
It's amazing how long this thing has been going on.
Can you imagine how it'd feel without him?
Now that I'm a Pez and a Lego, I don't really want for any more.
It's just, this is this gigantic thing. And it won't go away!
Okay. May the Force be with you.
I'm your father.